please kneel. Please kneel.
Let us pray. O God, who by the passion of Christ your Son, our Lord, abolished the death inherited from ancient sin by every succeeding generation, grant that just as being conformed to him, we have borne by the law of nature the image of the man of earth, so by the sanctification of grace we may bear the image of the man in heaven, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man, so shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless, for those who have not been told shall see, those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity, one of those from whom people hide their faces. Spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured. While we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted, but he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes, we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away, and who would have thought any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned him among the wicked and a burial place with evildoers. Though he had done no wrong, nor spoken any falsehood, but the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in the fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty. Because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked, and he shall take away the sins of many and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Father, into your hands.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has been similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So, let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading the Passion. You have parts assigned to you, and I urge you, it sure helps to help us feel the drama and to enter in deeply into the Passion if we speak these parts with using our full voices. Sometimes as Catholics we feel muted and so forth, but tonight please do your best to make this, to fill the space, and you'll help others to feel the Passion more deeply.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to where there was a garden into which he and his disciples entered. Judas, his betrayer, also knew the place because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him,
"Jesus of Nazareth."
He said to them,
"I am."
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. When he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They said,
"Jesus of Nazareth."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am. So if you are looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill what he had said, "I have not lost any of those you gave to me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword into its scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father gave me?"
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guards seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid who was the gatekeeper said to Peter, he said,
I am not.
Now the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they had made because it was cold and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in a synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gather. And in secret, I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said.
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
Is this the way you answer the high priest?
Jesus answered him,
If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?
Then Annas and him bound to Caiaphas the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him,
Are you
not one of his disciples, are you? He denied it and
said, I am not.
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said, Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled so they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
What charge do you bring against this man?
They answered and said to him, At this, Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law.
The Jews answered him, In order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
Are you the king of the Jews?
Jesus answered,
You say this on your own. Or have others told you about me?
Pilate answered,
I'm not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?
Jesus answered,
My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here.
So Pilate said to him,
Then you are a king.
Jesus answered,
You say, I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice.
Pilate said to him,
What is truth?
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?
They cried out again. Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said, And they struck him repeatedly. Once more Pilate went out and said to them,
Look, I'm bringing him out to you so that you may know that I find no guilt in him.
So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak, and Pilate said to them,
Behold the man.
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out, Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him.
The Jews answered, Now when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid and went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus,
Where are you from?
Jesus did not answer him. So Pilate said to him,
Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release you and I have the power to crucify you?
Jesus answered him,
You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin.
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in the place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the Jews,
Behold, your king.
They cried out,
Take him away, crucify him.
Pilate said to them,
Shall I crucify your king?
The chief priest answered,
We have no king but Caesar.
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews. Now many of the Jews read the inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priest of the Jews said to Pilate, Pilate answered,
What I have written, I have written.
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top down. So they said to one another, In order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled that says, They divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots. This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciples there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
Woman, behold your son.
Then he said to the disciple,
Behold your mother.
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
I thirst.
Now there was a vessel filled with common wine. So they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
It is finished.
And bowing his head, he handed over the spirit. Now, since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath of that week was a solemn one, The Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and then of the other one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled, not a bone of it will be broken. And again another passage says, they will look upon him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with a burial cloth along with the spices, according to the Jewish burial custom. Now in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by.
Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
That was the best participation of this entire week, no joke. As a kid, I would have been very squeamish about shouting, saying things loudly in church. And in general, that's a good practice. During Holy Week and during these readings, the church invites us to participate, all of us. Now, we're obviously not the ones that were responsible that day for the death of Jesus. But by entering deeply into it, we certainly take on responsibility, which is good. We help others to do the same. And there's a real spiritual benefit in terms of us not saying, well, that was what they did back then. How awful. It becomes more assimilated into our own life that sin is very similar to that in the rejection of Christ. The church wrote a while ago, the message of the liturgy in proclaiming the passion narratives in full is to enable the assembly to see vividly the love of Christ for each person despite their sins, a love that even death could not vanquish. As the church has always held, Christ suffered his passion freely and death because of the sins of all, that all might be saved. So there's a reason that those parts, which in the old liturgy would have been reserved to three different places, the priest and then two other voices. Now we have the priest and the voice and then the crowd. And that was a good change, I think, in terms of post-Vatican II, in that I think we really feel the passion narrative vividly, as the church wrote. And also, it helps us spiritually enter into that and not just say, again, this happened back then, it was those people, how awful they were, etc. It becomes more, it's ours as well. So I praise you for your strong participation in today's liturgy. And if you didn't, if you feel like, oh, I don't know if I want to do this, I do beg you to consider that this was a change that the church made, and I think one of the better ones too. Okay, homily. So today, I want to talk about how can God draw good out of evil? How can God draw good out of evil? This is a confusing and perplexing idea to the world. We live in an age in which there is an amazing availability of awful. Trademark pending on that one. That's my phrase. But I think that there's this day more than ever an ability to see awful so quickly. A few days ago, we saw that bridge collapse. And there are much worse things. There are medical conditions, there are tragedies, there are crimes. You can look and find instantly things that will make you feel bad, and in which there feels like there's not a second part of that story, that there's no redemption arc, there's just awful. And then, can God draw good out of every evil, even those things that we have no answers for? And in fact, yes, he is. Not only can he, but he is and he does at all times, in all places, and for all peoples. So let's first back up and say, because let's look at Good Friday. Some of the events that we shouted out. First, we have just some of the things that happened that day in terms of awful. We have a lifelong friend of one of the greatest men to ever live, who out of envy, greed, and who knows what else, sells this man for 30 pieces of silver, the price of a slave, to people he didn't like at all, to his enemies. And to identify this person, he betrays this person with a kiss. That same day, the best friend of this man swears, blasphemes, and perjures himself at a charcoal fire because a small girl asked him if he had a Galilean accent and if he knew this guy. We have a partisan crowd that is waving palm branches, and then today, 5 days later, after singing about how blessed he is and throwing down their cloaks on the ground for his arrival, demands the death of this man and calls him a criminal. But when pressed for the nature of this crime, they have no answer. They just simply shout louder, "Crucify him, kill him." And then to top it off, they choose instead to spare a convicted murderer instead of this person when given the opportunity. These are all awful things. We also have a judge who offers to release this man who he has examined and found innocent, but because of fear, condemns a man to death simply because of fear of other people. This day is called Good Friday, though. It is not Unspeakable Evil Friday. It's not No Justice Friday. It's not We Killed God Friday. It's called Good Friday. And I would guess that most of you on the daily basis use the word good. It's one of the first words that we teach our children. There are some small children here today. We teach them the first words are mama or dada. You know, depending on who gets to spend more time, that child might say it, or he might betray and then say dada when mom spends all time with him, but you guys know that better than I do. But children learn words, mama, dada. They learn yes and no. They learn no very well. They learn more. They learn thank you. They learn please. And then they learn the word good. And we teach them that, but we never really define it. Good is used, and what does it mean? Does it mean pleasing, consoling? Does it mean happy? Does it mean kindness? Does it mean love? What does it mean? Most of us now use the word good, and we don't give a second thought that as we declare all things good, whether that's Chipotle, whether that's the homily, whether that's the way I felt this morning. Good is all over the place. What does it mean to use the word good? John Paul II deals with this word good in his famous encyclical Veritatis Splendor, which when you read it, you feel as if it still stands the test of time. It's amazing. Called On the Splendor of Truth. And he says this. So this is John Paul II in his encyclical Veritatis Splendor. Jesus says, "Why do you ask me about what is good?" This is the encounter with the rich young man. "There is only one who is good. If you wish to enter into life, keep the commandments." In the versions of the evangelists Mark and Luke, the question is phrased this way. "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone." Before answering the question, Jesus wishes the young man to have a clear idea of why he asked his question. And the good teacher points out to him and to all of us that the answer to this question, "What good must I do to inherit eternal life?" can only be found by turning one's heart and mind to the one who is good. No one is good but God alone. Only God can answer the question about what is good, because he is the good itself. And to ask about the good ultimately, in fact, means to turn towards God, the fullness of goodness. The good from Good Friday was not realized by many that day. And we would always like to see the good in advance. We'd like to know what kind of return on investment we're going to get. So if we invest in an exercise program, we want to know what we're going to look like afterwards. If we invest in a stock, we want to know what's the rate of return on this. If we go to this college, what kind of degree am I going to get? Where am I going to get a job? If I marry you, what's going to happen? If I choose to spend my time and my money and energy in this way, tell me what's going to happen, how's it going to happen, and when's it going to happen? We want to see in advance and know for ourselves. That is not possible. And especially when it comes to God, we would like to know in advance what's going to happen. But we have to exercise trust. So one of my favorite psalms is Psalm 116. Now in it, the psalmist describes how he went through something and what happened and what he said. He says, quote, "The cords of death entangled me. The anguish of the grave came over me. I was overcome by distress and sorrow." Pretty dramatic. Sounds like a middle schooler that has to write a paper for tomorrow or clean their room. Oh, death, I might as well die. But we can imagine that the psalmist went through something worse than being asked to pick up his clothes or to take the folded clothes to their room or to do something, anything that's mildly taxing. That this psalmist probably went through something really horrible. And he describes what he prayed when he was in that place. He said this, "I trusted in the Lord when I said, I am greatly afflicted." I was greatly afflicted. What was my response? I trusted in the Lord. It's one of my favorite lines. Things that are evil or we perceive as evil require trust, and they ask something of us. And they ask us, even though we can't see what's on the other side of that, to say, I choose to trust. Theologians call this like a testing or a test. And we know this because we just went through Lent with Abraham and his Isaac test. We saw all the promises that God said, you can't see this thing, but I'm going to ask you to trust. I'm going to ask you to believe that it will be accomplished even though you don't get to see until maybe after it's done. And I thought about that exercise in trust because of something that my own life recently. When I was ordained 5 years ago, I received the double assignment of Holy Trinity and St. James. And I loved that assignment at St. James because I love the gift that young people are to the church. That young people bring joy and humor and fearlessness and boldness and curiosity. They ask good questions. Young people say yes easily to things, at least when they're at school. And they bring energy to the church, especially if they've had Celsius and Starbucks and all the things that your credit cards bought them that morning. And I was certainly not a fan then of being reassigned, and I was certainly not a fan of being reassigned in the middle of the year. And I thought, why is this happening? There's no reason or rhyme. There's not a lot of sense to it. It's a dumb idea, and I don't like it, and a lot of other things. My last week at the high school, a week after I had told the children that I would be coming back to St. Joseph, or coming to St. Joseph full time, and I wasn't upset because of the parish. I was upset because of what I was leaving and the timing. The week I went on a mission trip with the kids I went to Louisiana. And that morning, the ambulances came to our house because Father Travis had his heart defibrillation issue. Fast forward to just a few weeks ago, in which once again I was leaving for Louisiana. This time I was going on an 8-day retreat. And once again, this time I was in the airport parking lot getting off the shuttle. And Father Scott, this time, texted me and said, Father Travis is going to the hospital. He has kidney and liver failure issues. Please pray for him. So two things are the result of these episodes. One, I have been forever banned from going to Louisiana because Father Scott says nothing good happens when you go there. So there's a standing order to not let me in. The second thing is perhaps being able to see, again, the idea that there is good or God can draw good out of things even that we perceive as not good. that surely in these last few months when he has been ill and ultimately died, there may have been good in here, in that I am here all the time now. If we believe, though, that suffering is an enemy and something to be avoided, we will never be able to understand goodness, period. If suffering is always looked upon as something that is inherently evil, and we don't understand, and it doesn't make any sense, and we don't want it, we'll never understand good. Now, we consider the apostles. In a few weeks, or if rather, in about a few days, we're going to be reading for 50 days. We're going to be stuck in Acts of the Apostles. We're going to read a lot of Acts of the Apostles. And we're going to read about a very interesting episode. At one point, the apostles are beaten and abused by the Jewish authorities. The Jews call them in and say, quit talking about Jesus. Stop it. And then they whipped them and beat them and sent them on their way. And the apostles' response is this. This is Acts 5. So they left the presence of the Sanhedrin, rejoicing that they had been found worthy to suffer dishonor for the sake of the name. They kicked our butts. Hooray! Let's do it again. But there was no sarcasm or anger or bitterness. They rejoiced authentically that they had been found worthy to suffer. Or as we read in Hebrews, thanks Mr. Wahlberg, son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. Good Friday pairs the suffering servant with the ultimate good. What do I mean by that? One of the mistakes of Good Friday is to assume simply that the mission of Jesus was to come to save us from our sins, period. He died for your sins. We see this on billboards, in advertisements, etc. That's the mission of Jesus, to come to die for our sins. That's very incomplete. St. Thomas Aquinas points out that God could have chosen to forgive the sins however he wanted to. That is, the owner of the debt, he can do whatever he wants to. When Father Scott forgives me, he doesn't ask for anything. He just does it. He doesn't demand that I crawl on my knees or humiliate myself. In the same way that God holds the debt, he didn't have to have his son die. He didn't have to ask him to be obedient to the point of death. He could have just canceled the debt. So there's a little bit of a danger in saying, well, he had to send his son, etc. He could have just dismissed it. We go back to today's drama. On the one hand, we see the worst of humanity. We see the people in the drama acting at their worst, whether it's Judas or Peter or Pilate, etc. We see the humiliation. We see a drunken mob of 600 soldiers mocking the Son of God. But we also see the best. As Dickens might say, it was the best of times, it was the worst of times, right? Although we've only read page one of that book. We don't really know what the rest of it is, right? We just know, oh, I know the quote. No one read the rest of it. When the crowd shouted, which we read in Matthew's gospel, they said, his blood be on us and our children. It's a pretty dramatic line. They're saying, we'll take ownership. We'll take it. We know what we're doing. It's us. We're killing him. We're good with it. Blame us. It's actually a prophecy, though. His blood will be on you and your children. His blood will be poured out on your children's children. And the catechism said that there's not a single person that has ever been born or will be born that Jesus did not die for, period. It's a great line to keep in your belt. When you see somebody on the street, you're like, ugh. There's not a single person. When they chose Barabbas over Jesus, and Matthew's gospel in many copies says Jesus Barabbas, which is fascinating. Jesus Barabbas, son of the Father, or Jesus Christ, the actual son of the Father. And they chose wrongly to kill Jesus Christ rather than Jesus, son of the Father. They actually chose rightly. And even though they intended knowingly to put an innocent man to death and chose wrongly, they chose rightly. They did good that day. We think back to Joseph in the Old Testament, a young boy that was hated by his brothers. He's got that fancy coat. His dad loves him. We hate that guy. And they put him in a cistern and they sold him. Five times, says the Jews, he was sold. They did so much good that day, even though they intended so much evil. Genesis 50 says this. This is after Joseph has saved Israel and all his sons and the entire nation from famine. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, "What if Joseph holds a grudge against us and pays us back for all the wrongs we did to him?" And so they sent word to Joseph saying, "Your father left us these instructions before he died. This is what you are to say to Joseph. I ask you to forgive your brothers the sins and the wrongs they committed in treating you so badly. Now please forgive the sins of your servants of God, of the God of your father." And when their message came to him, Joseph wept. His brothers threw themselves down and said, "We are your slaves." But Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives." It's Good Friday, not just because God died for your sins. It's Good Friday, not just because God loves you so much, and that's true, those are all true. It is so that Jesus died so that we could become good. And this is important. Again, John Paul said, goodness, it comes from God because God is good. We call it Good Friday because of the graces that were won on that cross, make us and transform us into the good. Sanctifying grace, Father Scott talked about last night at Holy Thursday. The graces that are won don't just save us. They divinize. They make us like him. They make us good. And what's interesting is the opening prayer actually says that. It was in there. You may not have noticed it. I didn't either until the second time tonight. It says this: O God, who by the passion of Christ, your Son, our Lord, abolished the death inherited from ancient sin. That's the first part, right? God died for our sins. Yes. Grant that just as being conformed to him, we have borne by the law of nature the image of the man on earth, so by the sanctification of grace, we may bear the image of man in heaven. 1 and 2. Not just forgiven, but the good that is accomplished today is so much more. You know, I'll end with this. As a kid, I always acted sad on Good Friday. I thought that's what you're supposed to do. On Good Friday, we walk around and we look really sad. They killed God. You know, you gotta look sad today. It's a sad day. This is true to some extent. There's a sobriety, of course, today. We are sober upon the death of Jesus. But the good is not sarcasm, irony, any of those things. It's called Good Friday because of the good that we have the opportunity, that his graces, his infinite graces, always available to us, make us like the good himself. That this day, Good Friday, is the best of days because we have seen the worst, but at the same time, we have the best thing available now. The opportunity to become like God, to become the image of his Son. We now stand, I think. Actually, wait, is it the collection now? Collection first? Intercessions, and then we'll take the collection for the Holy Land. So please stand for our solemn intercessions.
I let you sit for a long time because we have to stand for a bit for the solemn intercessions. And we'll...
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God the Father Almighty. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to all the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church, spread throughout all the world, may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church to govern the holy people of God. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people, governed by you their Maker, may grow in merit by reason of their faith, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for our Archbishop Joseph, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the church, and for the whole of the faithful people. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace all may serve you faithfully through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for our catechumens, that our God and Lord may open wide the ears of their inmost hearts and unlock the gates of his mercy, that having received forgiveness of all their sins through the waters of rebirth, they too may be one with Christ Jesus our Lord. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, who make your church ever fruitful with new offspring, increase the faith and understanding of our catechumens, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for all our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased as they live the truth, to gather them together and keep them in his one church. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for the Jewish people, to whom the Lord our God spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to his covenant. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, grant to those who do not confess Christ that by walking before you with a sincere heart they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right with sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God Himself. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, who created all people to seek you always by desiring you and by finding you come to rest, grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love and the witness of the good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you, the one true God and Father of our human race, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those in public office, that our God and Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to His will, for the true peace and freedom of all. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, in whose hand lies every human heart and the rights of peoples, look with favor, we pray, on those who govern us with authority over us, that throughout the whole world the prosperity of peoples, the assurances of peace, and freedom of religion may through your gift be made secure, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that He may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying. Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice, because in their hour of need your mercy was at hand, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Seated now for the collection for the Holy Land. So as our ushers are collecting, we encourage your generosity now more than ever. It's difficult to operate any business in Israel. And for sure, having visited there, I can testify to that, that those who live there, it is very, very challenging. And to keep open all the shrines and the holy places that hopefully one day you get to visit, the sacred places that our Lord walked, and the churches and so forth that are built there, it's not easy. I always used to wonder as a kid what this collection went to, and for sure that defrays a lot of those difficulties, because it just is not easy to be a Christian and to live in that place, especially now. So I again encourage your generosity. I know that maybe some of you have never been there, and again, I hope you get to go there, but please know that it is a great benefit to keep those places run by Christians and in good hands and available to all those who visit. Also, as we're doing this, I want to remind you that this is the beginning. If you're intending to do Novena to end on Divine Mercy Sunday, which is not this Sunday, obviously, but the next one, you want to begin that Novena sometime today. The 9 days begins today. So please, and again, I think those are outside of the narthex, and you can find that in our bulletin online.
And also because I have no shame, the young adult group, Joe and Co., is having a talk on Divine Mercy Sunday on Monday after Easter. That's 2 days from now, 3 days from now, rather. It's going to be fantastic. I see a lot of you out there that are 21 to 39, and so it would be great to see you there. I'm truly excited deeply and authentically about this young adult group and for the community that we're helping to grow. And again, it's not just for singles and so forth. If you're in that age range, you are absolutely invited, and you can bring your babies if you have babies and so forth. But tomorrow on Monday, we're excited to have Ms. Garza from St. James Academy coming to talk about Divine Mercy, and so we hope to see you there that Monday night to talk. In a moment, we'll have the adoration, or the veneration, rather, of the cross. This is always an area where, at least as a kid, no one really said what to do. You were invited to venerate the cross in whatever way you wish to show love and devotion. So whether that's a kiss, or a genuflection, or just a gesture with your hand, those are all acceptable and beautiful ways. So don't feel any pressure to do one way or the other, in whatever way that the Holy Spirit moves you to venerate the wood of our salvation. Please do so. Please stand. Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us adore.
Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us adore.
Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
Come, let us adore.
During this time, this year, to make it go faster, we're still using one cross. The church mandates that we do that, but the ushers will move us in sections so we don't have to have all the ineffective zippering as in years past, okay? So you will get to go, but please trust in the ushers as they direct you by section. It's proven to be a little faster this year to do it that way. Thank you. You're welcome to kneel during this time or to be seated.
Thank you.
The third part of today's service is the distribution of Holy Communion. If you would please stand. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day
our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Now please kneel. May the receiving of your body and blood, Lord Jesus Christ, not through your judgment and condemnation, but through your love and mercy, be for me protection of mind and body and to healing remedy. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, may the body of Christ keep me safe for eternal life. May abundant blessing, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people who have honored the death of your Son in the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So tomorrow is Holy Saturday, and we will genuflect to the cross. You're, I think, invited to do the same in a very unique thing tonight. We genuflect to the cross.